Principles of Finance, a la Schmup. A Brief History of Foreign Exchange. So, Bretton Woods. Yeah, the meeting thing. No relation to Tiger here. Bretton Woods fixed exchange rates for strategic reasons. And yeah, we're not talking about some country club kid named Bretton. Well, the Bretton Woods Agreement was established in 1944 near the end of World War II between the U.S. and a few other countries who all agreed that it might be in everyone's best interest to, get along. And not just in terms of blowing up enemies, but also in terms of trade. So these countries all got together and they decided how much each country's currency was worth relative to every other country's currency and decided to set those currencies at a fixed rate and or range, thereby allowing for future international trade, right? And trade is good. It gives people something to lose when they go to war against each other. So that was fixed. They fixed their rates within a pretty tight range. However, floating is vastly the more common form in which currencies around the world trade today. The floating thing basically just means that there are no rules for how one currency is valued relative to another the way there were in the Bretton Woods era for a few years after World War II. If suddenly Putin decides to print boatloads of rubles, destroying the relative value of their currency more or less against all other currencies in the world by creating so much supply and basically flat demand, then the ruble to dollar exchange rate might suddenly gap down to, a dollar buying 100 rubles instead of 50 or 60 it was buying last month. Well, the same can work in the other direction as well. If the Russian Fed or central bank decides to raise rates dramatically, wanting to protect the value of its currency globally, making its currency more scarce, like less supply and or more precious, well, the same exchange rate might suddenly float the other way. Like all of a sudden, a dollar only buys 20 rubles and maybe less. Or the reverse could be true, that you might go back to a world where a dollar bought you 20 rubles to one ruble buying $20. Like the whole thing could flip and the world values Russian currency more than American, but we guffaw at this notion because we're Americans, right? Well, if the Russians end up defending their currency the way they've defended their best election hackers, you never know. All right, well, you can imagine how a country could go bankrupt trying to defend its currency. An easy path there, and this path almost bankrupted Europe when the euro came out, was to set a price ceiling. That is, you set a maximum exchange rate so that your currency is never valued less than some ratio to a hard currency like the US dollar. Well, at that time, commodity traders took big advantage of the European Central Bank's narrow-mindedness, and, well, they made a killing, essentially shorting the euro just before it started to float. Now, move this thinking to Moscow. Like, let's say that Russia demanded that buyers never be able to buy 100 rubles for less than a dollar. If the ruble declined in relative value so that the floating exchange rate got to the point where a dollar was buying 101 rubles, well, then Russia would essentially have to be buying back its own rubles, like using, quote, hard currencies, unquote, that it had accumulated from trading with other countries to do so, like using dollars and Chinese yuan and Japanese yen and so on to then buy. Well, Russia would be hoping to constrain world supply, keeping its ruble prized at 100 to 1, at least against the dollar. And why would this matter? If Russia had to buy product using rubles from the U.S., which only took U.S. dollars, and it couldn't pay for those products in barter, i.e. things it owns tons of, like natural gas and lumber and Russians, the more prized the ruble relative to the dollar, the cheaper those U.S. products would be to the Russian buyer who's buying in rubles. Think about a Chevy Bolt. Well, it would go from costing $30,000 and 300,000 rubles to still costing $30,000, but only requiring 100,000 rubles for Mr. Putin to add this awesome car to his collection. Got it? So 100 to 1 there. Okay, so how does all this work at scale? Like, it's more than just being about some weird American with a fetish for zombies and nuclear waste wanting to do one transaction in the balmy green suburbs of Chernobyl. Why do we need to worry so much about foreign currency relative valuations anyway? Well, because business does. You like to eat, right? Eat, as in wine, French cheeses, vodka from Russia, thank you very much, caviar, glows in the dark, that Swedish herring thing that makes people dry heave when they smell it. Well, it's likely you'll get a job in a business, then that business will be highly affected by the prices at which it exports its product and the prices of the commodities it imports, often from overseas vendors to build its product. Right? Like, think of a Swedish boat company importing wood and guidance systems and heat. Well, this currency exchange process is a huge part of the global economy.
Illustrative example time!
Consider that, you're an American underwear seller. Call them Barbara's Boxers. Doing business selling underwear to Latin American drug lords in the 90s when the Colombian peso was inflating at about 1% a day. Yes, that's right, per day, like 400% plus annualized. Well, you'd sell what was at the time $10,000 worth of your no-go commando line of underwear to the drug lords. But then if you were paid 30 days later, well, the bill was to be paid as $1,000,000 pesos. And yes, we're rounding exchange rates here a lot just to make the math easy. So a month passes and you actually get paid $1,000,000 Colombian pesos. And yes, you're thankful to have been paid. You really didn't want to have to send the guys with the baseball bats after the drug lords. Those bats always seem to disappear when the guys are sent home. But you were paid $1,000,000 Colombian pesos 30 days later. That's the good news. The bad news? Well, it's that the value of those million pesos declined by a lot. The new value of those million pesos under 1% a day inflation? Well, it was a million divided by 1.01 to the 30th power. There, a million over about 1.35, call it. Or rather, that $1,000,000 buying power 30 days later was only 742,000 pesos worth, give or take. The $10,000 worth of revenues you originally got from the sale ended up being more like, 7,420-ish and change. And that's a huge problem in the underwear industry, which is inherently low margin, low profit margin to begin with. And drops in purchasing power, or rather the negative effects of hyperinflation, take a company doing business profitably to one not doing business profitably. So this transaction was a deal consummated with currency rates fully floating, likely with both the seller and the buyer knowing that there was massive inflation coming. The values of exchange were initially calculated on the spot that moment, and that flavor of transaction is called, yes, a spot rate. It's the simplest kind of transaction, and unfortunately, with no protection, ends up with your company going bust or losing big money on the sale. Yeah, the kissing cousin to a spot rate is a forward rate or forward transaction. In this structure, a deal is cut such that in N days, some number of days or weeks or months or whatever, one party delivers a given value in a set currency. Like you could have said, in 30 days, you will pay me $10,000 for this load of underwear. That is, the drug lords would have been liable for the forward pricing of that product. And instead of the million Colombian pesos buying only 7,400 bucks and change, they would have had to have come up with something like 1.3 million pesos to then buy $10,000 worth of the underwear and, pay their bill. That way, in this example, the buyer bears the risk of the currency, not the seller. The basic idea is that since Bretton Woods ended, foreign exchange is only and always will be a moving target. And in order to not be destroyed by transactions where the currency ratios go against you, you have to aim your arrows well in front of the direction the key currencies you care about are moving, especially when you really care.